My name's Rebecca West, and I welcome you all very much for coming to my talk today. I'm someone who has been here for 40 years. In fact, I'm retiring very soon. I'm not leaving, but I am retiring officially at the end of December. And so it's kind of a bittersweet time for me. But I've for many years have taught in the Romance Languages Department. I teach Italian literature, modern and contemporary Italian literature and culture. And I also have been in the Cinema and Media Studies program for many years, where I teach not so much Italian topics as topics having to do with adaptation, of which this work on Pinocchio is a part, books that are then turned into films. So today, and don't let this scare you, I'm not going to stand here and read you, 40 pages worth of stuff, but just to be able to refresh my memory about some points that I want to make. But I will read a little bit of this introductory part. Can you all hear me okay? Is it fine? Okay. So there are many ways of approaching the study of Collodi's Pinocchio. For example, some recent scholarship, including work done by Italian scholars, has concentrated on a perceived connection between the puppet's characteristics and something like an essential or even maybe stereotypical Italian national character. So the idea is that flexibility, adaptability, wiliness, optimism, generosity of spirit, a certain greediness or a lust for life, a love for family, and so on, that all of these things that we see in the little puppet reflect something about the Italian national character. Other scholars have focused on the ways in which Pinocchio is a central text for understanding the historical period of immediate post-unification Italy. That is when essentially the book came out in the 1880s. Italy really was not united and did not become a nation until ultimately 1871, when the entire nation came together. So it was only a few years after that that Pinocchio appeared. Now, how does Pinocchio connect with this period, historical period? Well, attention is given to how individualism was played down in order to create communal concepts of citizenship. So regionalisms, dialects, foreign influences, and so on had to be tamed or repressed in order for a monolithic entity, Italy, to be truly born. And so Pinocchio has been seen metaphorically as a tale about the nationalistic attempts in the 1880s to carve out and fashion a political body or collective citizenry from the fiction of a single bloc. And the puppet itself can be read as the emergent modern liberal Italian, torn between the, on the one hand, the social bond, that is being a puppet with strings attached, and on the other, personal autonomy. So how these two things could be legislated and understood in this new nation of Italy. And comparisons have been made between this kind of analysis, this sort of political, social-political analysis of Pinocchio, and analyses of other national constructions that probe politically symbolic literary creations, such as Frankenstein or Jekyll and Hyde, believe it or not. So Frankenstein has been studied, for example, as the stitched-together patchwork body of British imperialism, while the later Jekyll and Hyde has been read as expressing anxieties of its age regarding personal identity and the claims, again, between the state and the individual. So these kinds of approaches, you know, these metaphorical, historical, political approaches, especially the idea of a connection between Pinocchio's character and the Italian national character, I think have genuine relevance in today's global context, in which important shifts in the makeup of the European citizenry due to massive immigration from non-European areas, such as Africa and the Middle East, building what in Italy has even been called Eurabia, are affecting Italian identity, both collective and individual. And similarly, the studies that are looking backwards to the period of Italian nation building intersect with current work on the reemergence in Italy and elsewhere of local cultures and dialects. That is, the idea that after this period of intense unification, a monolithic concept of the state and of the nation, we now are seeing regionalisms, dialects, specific, like locavore food and so on. All of these things are coming back to the fore. So Pinocchio, the little puppet, can bear a pretty heavy weight on his wooden shoulders when it comes to the kinds of analyses that have been done and continue to be done. Pinocchio can also be analyzed and talked about as having something to do with the borders between the human and the non or the post-human, obviously, because he's a puppet, but he's a talking, walking puppet, and who aspires to be a real boy, whatever that might mean. And this approach connects well with cinema studies, in which I've been working, as I said, for quite a number of years. Because cinema studies, from the very beginning, have talked about the intersections of the animate and the inanimate. Early cinema was, of course, had everything to do with bringing the animate, to animating, to bringing the moving world into some kind of visual context for people to be able to observe. And in the early times, this was, of course, seen as miraculous. You know, there was something even frightening about the way in which people could go into a movie theater or into a Nickelodeon and see moving images in front of their eyes. You may have all heard of the story of one of the earliest short films, which is simply a train coming towards the screen, and how the audience was frightened. You know, they couldn't quite understand the difference between the framed image and real life. But as sort of far off as this all seems from Pinocchio, I think it does have something to do with the way in which Pinocchio has maintained what I have called his afterlife. You know, this long period since the 1880s, when Pinocchio was first created as a little children's story, to today, so many years later, over 100 years later, I'm sure that his creator, Carlo Lorenzini, who used the pen name Collodi, would never have imagined that this little story that he put together to entertain children and to make money would have remained so popular and so interesting to so many different areas of scholarly work. It's similar, by the way, to some work that another colleague here, Tom Mitchell, who works a lot on visual culture, has done on the question of the role of the dinosaur in our culture. And there's another scholar who has now retired, who was at the University of Pennsylvania, who worked for years on the vampire, you know, on the figure of the vampire. Why do vampires keep popping up in culture, you know, and even today, look at the popularity of vampires, right? They're all over the place. And within the Italian context, I would argue that Pinocchio has that kind of role. I mean, that he comes out of Italian culture, but then kind of goes global and becomes a symbol of something far beyond what he originally was intended to be or mean. So my own work on Pinocchio has taken various directions, but mostly I've worked at cinematic versions of Pinocchio, of which there are many. But the most known and the most, in a way, important are ones that we'll see just very short clips of, just to remind you of them. Disney's 1940 version of Pinocchio. How many of you have seen? Yeah. So this is the Pinocchio we know, right? This is the Pinocchio, not just in American culture, but even in Italy. Little kids in Italy know Walt Disney's Pinocchio much better than they know the book. You know, the book is not read a whole lot anymore. But most of the kids, you know, have a chance to see the movie. So their idea of Pinocchio is very similar to ours. It's this cute little chubby scamp, you know, who kind of already looks like a little boy and who gets himself into a lot of trouble because he's so curious. You know, he's kind of a sweet little child, rather than, as in the original, a rather mysterious figure who is illustrated as looking very much like a carved piece of wood, you know, not at all a cute little boy, and who gets into trouble not just because he's curious, as every child is, but because there's something, you know, innately mischievous and maybe even slightly bad about this little piece of wood, right? He's not just an anodyne, cute, benign little person or little figure. However, the Disney version has dominated. You know, that's the one that we all know. It's the one we all remember. However, there have been something like at least 15 versions in English on the screen of Pinocchio, and there have been versions in practically every language you can imagine, both written versions and cinematic versions. So, you know, there's an Egyptian Pinocchio, there's an African Pinocchio, there's a Czech Pinocchio. You know, everywhere you look, there are cinematic versions of this book. And not only, but the book has also influenced films that are not direct adaptations of Pinocchio. For example, I think of the work of the amazing Czech surrealist filmmaker Jan Švankmajer, who you may have seen one of his films called Little Odic. Anyone ever see this? Yeah, it's really a strange film, right? I mean, all of his films are, visually and in other ways. But it's the story, essentially, of a baby made out of a piece of a tree, right? And he uses this animated figure, which is creepy as all get out, you know, because it doesn't even look totally humanoid. A little baby with branches instead of arms and a little stump, you know, a little sort of knob for a nose and so on, who ends up sort of devouring everything around him, including his parents. But Pinocchio is clearly there somehow in this figure of little Odic. And another film in fairly recent times that plays with the idea of the figure that wants to be a real boy is Spielberg's Artificial Intelligence, AI. Have you guys seen that film? Yeah. You know, in which the story of Pinocchio is even inscribed into that film because it's the book that the mother, the human mother, reads to her little robotic child. And he, of course, goes on his great trek to discover who? The Blue Fairy, right? Who is a figure from the original story of Pinocchio. He wants to find the Blue Fairy because he believes the Blue Fairy will be able to make him a real boy. So even in a film as recent as AI, we see, again, the importance, the role of Pinocchio. And finally, there is Roberto Benigni's rather disastrous failure of 2002, his version of Pinocchio. Have any of you seen that? No. Well, it's a sad story, actually, because you know Roberto Benigni, who's the comic actor of Life is Beautiful, which won the Academy Award. Wonderful, wonderful comic actor. And it was a dream of his lifetime to produce a film based on Pinocchio, and in fact to play Pinocchio, which he does, much to the sorrow of many of his members of his audience, because he was already a bit long in the tooth. He was over 50 when he was playing Pinocchio, and he looks utterly exhausted the whole way through the film because he was directing it, producing it, acting in it, and there are problems. There are severe problems with his version of Pinocchio, which is in fact much closer to the original, much much closer than anything Disney came up with. But unfortunately, it kind of falls flat. I think it's worth seeing. In fact, it was just on television the other night. Part of the problem with Benigni's Pinocchio is that it's dubbed. And a huge part of, I'm not even sure that, you know, Benigni can be translated meaningfully, because so much of his comedy is verbal. It's the way he speaks Tuscan dialect. It's his accent. It's his verbal wittiness. And the dubbing is very poor, you know, and so you have this sense of, you know how when films are dubbed poorly and you have a sense of how artificial it is? Well, unfortunately, that's true of Benigni's film. But nonetheless, my point is that there are so many versions, cinematic versions, and not only cinematic versions, but there are also literary adaptations. Walt Disney's film of 1940 was based not on Collodi's book, but on a stage play that had been done in English in New York, a Broadway stage play, which had already modified Collodi's book quite a bit. But there are also many, many authors, so-called serious authors, you know, as opposed to children's authors. I think the distinction is a little artificial, but who have used Pinocchio as inspiration for their work. In the Italian context, the names that probably would be most broadly recognized would be Italo Calvino. Calvino's first novel, called The Path to the Nest of Spiders, which was a kind of neo-realist novel about a boy who joins the Italian resistance, is, believe it or not, very closely allied to Pinocchio. The boy's name is Pin, based on Pinocchio, and he has a series of adventures, like the first original Adventures of Pinocchio. And Calvino himself often said that Pinocchio, the book, was one of his major sources of inspiration, not just for that novel, but for other work he did. And the other name that I'm sure you would recognize is Umberto Eco, of the Name of the Rose fame, who, when he was teaching at the University of Bologna, he was a very inventive professor, and he would have his students do the most wonderful exercises. And one of the exercises was to write a short version of the story of Pinocchio using words beginning with the letter P only, okay? And the students did a masterful job, and they came out with, he came out with a book of this student-created version of Pinocchio with every single word beginning with the letter P. And I translated a bit of this as best I could into English, trying to keep the P. And this is how it begins. Poor Papa Pepe, Giuseppe, or, Geppetto. Poor Papa Pepe, primarily penurially pinched, picks paltry pine piece, perfectly prepared, projects puppet prefabrication. That's pretty good. I mean, and this is, you know, pretty much a literal translation of the original Italian. And it really, this exercise is so wonderful because, of course, it helped the students to develop this massive vocabulary of words beginning with P. You know, I'm sure they now know all the entries in the P part of the dictionary. But also, it made them do a kind of commentary on the book, you know, because they had to interpret it as they were translating it into this this form. And the two words that are highlighted over and over in this version are the words poverty and penury, both, you know, indicating the lack of money in this world in which Pinocchio is born and lives. Finally, they highlight the blue fairy, whom they call a providenziale pulzella, which means a providential poppet, And as you recall, the blue fairy is this feminine figure. She is a kind of fairy godmother. But in the original book, she takes different forms. She's a little girl. She's a mother figure. She's a kind of fairy godmother. She's a very important figure in the second half of the book. And the final lines, I just want to quote you the final lines of this version by Eco's students, which I think are wonderful. Paradoxical? Possible? Puppet? Primate? Proteiform pest? Perennial Peter Pan? Proverbial parable? Practically psychoanalytical? I think it's just terrific. Okay. So I just want to say just a couple of words about the original book before we move to considering the films. And first of all, the book was published, as I said, in the early 1980s, and it was published in serial form, as so many books were. What did I say, 19? Oh, well. Thank you. And it was published in serial form, which, as you know, is the way Dickens published so many authors of the late 1900s, published in magazines in serial form. And it was published in a children's magazine. And after Collodi had published, I think about 15 chapters, he essentially killed Pinocchio off. He had him hung in this final chapter. He's chased by the thieves, the dangerous thieves, who, to get rid of him, string him up. And he's left dangling. And according to Collodi, that was it for him. He said, I've had it. I've written enough of this. There was such a clamor from his readership and probably from the parents of the children saying, how dare you kill off our favorite little puppet, that he came back to the text and he wrote another, essentially the same number of chapters, about another 16 or 17 chapters, in which the adventures continue. So luckily we have this much longer book. The first half of the book is mostly about the terrible troubles that Pinocchio gets into, and the second half as well, but the second half is much more pedagogical or didactical in tone, and it becomes more and more about how he should be a good boy, and he should learn to, you know, support his old father, and he should go to work, and the fairy is there punishing him from time to time, you know, like a good mother who's strict but loving, and she'll get him out of trouble, but she'll say, you've got to stop being so bad. And of course, in the end, he is transformed into a good little boy, to the great dismay of readers probably forever, because who wants the good little boy? You know, we're not interested in the good little boy, we're interested in the bad little puppet. And the book almost immediately was translated into English and into a number of languages, and ever since then has been translated. In fact, a translation, yet another translation, just came out with the publishing group called the New York Review Books Classics, which I did a tiny little introduction for, and Umberto Eco also wrote something for that that edition. And it's I recommend it. You know, if you want to read the book again, look at that little paperback put out by the New York Review Classics, because it's really very well done. So it's gone on. As I said, its afterlife is quite remarkable. The other way in which Pinocchio has continued to live, and I'm sure you've all noticed this, is so often in the newspaper, you'll open it up and there'll be a Pinocchio figure, you know, with the long nose. And what will the article be about? Politics. Right? I mean, it's become this kind of universal symbol of lying politicians. And I have a file on this from Italy, from France, from all around the world. You know, inevitably, newspapers, journalists will go to this image of the puppet with the long nose, the lying puppet. So Pinocchio has become a kind of universal symbol of mendacity, of dishonesty. Also, as you, I'm sure, are aware, especially if you've done any travel in Italy, it's become, the figure of Pinocchio has generated a tremendous business in essentially trinkets and junk. You know, I mean, you can get very cute, very nice little figures of Pinocchio, but you also just see everywhere. I mean, now, not just in Tuscany, which is where Collodi lived, in Florence and in Tuscany in general, but everywhere in Italy. And I was in Rome for Christmas season 1 year, not so long ago, and sure enough, everywhere you went, you know, there would be little booths of children's toys, and there would be, you know, hundreds and hundreds of little Pinocchio figures, little wooden Pinocchios. So there's quite an industry based on, I even have kitchen implements that are Pinocchios. I have a collection. Got kind of fanatic about this about 10 years ago and started collecting all of these strange things. I mean, I have, you know, hair ribbons, and I have handkerchiefs and kitchen. I have a kitchen funnel. The nose is the funnel. Just on and on. Whatever you might want, I think you can find in the form of Pinocchio. So I thought today, just for another, 10 or 15 minutes, because I do want to leave us some time for chatting, that I would talk briefly about the films, starting with Disney's film, and then talking a little bit about Benigni's film, and then we'll see just the beginnings of those films, just to remind you of, you know, of what they look like. And then we'll open it up for some discussion. Okay, so as I said, Walt Disney's film came out in 1940. Disney had already produced his film Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, which came out in 1937. And in fact, the Russian director Eisenstein, the great Eisenstein, called Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs the greatest film ever made. And the reason that he said this is because for him, what was so amazing was what animation could do, what cartoons could do. He saw it as tremendous liberation, right? Because you could show any vision you had. You could make a world work in whatever way you wanted it to work on screen. And for Eisenstein and for so many filmmakers, this was a tremendous advancement. So Pinocchio built on the achievements in animation, technical achievements of Snow White and also of Disney's Fantasia, which you may have seen. And Roger Ebert said that Pinocchio came together to form a kind of what he called collective creative epiphany. Ebert really just couldn't praise Pinocchio enough, the film. And there are specific technical innovations in this film, which we'll see an example of just in a bit of the opening portion of the film. And for one, there's the breaking of the frame. That means that space is implied outside of the screen, right? We're very used to this now. We see this all the time in live action, where you're looking at a certain scene, but you know that something's going on out there beyond the frame that we can't quite see. And of course, it gives a sense of realism. It gives a sense that what we're seeing is just a little portion of the world, but that it is part of this broader world. And this technique of breaking the frame was used in live action movies, had been used for years, for decades, but not in cartoons, not in animation. And Disney's people made this possible. There's a scene, for example, if you watch the movie again yourself, when Pinocchio and Geppetto are expelled by the whale sneezing, you know, they're inside the whale's stomach, and the monstro, the whale, sneezes, and they're forced out, and then they're drawn back in, and then they're expelled again, but we don't see the whale. What we see are the figures of Geppetto and Pinocchio. But there's a palpable sense that the whale is there, right? Just beyond our sight, just beyond the frame. And another innovation was the use of the multiplane camera, which allowed the wonderful animation artist to draw in three dimensions for this film. So the camera seems to pass through foreground drawings on its way deeper into the frame and creates a great sense of depth. And we can see this in the opening aerial shot of Pinocchio's village. So I thought maybe we could just take a look at the very beginning of the film, maybe point out a couple of other little elements about it, and then pay attention to how we have this aerial shot that goes through and finally takes us down into Pinocchio and Geppetto's little village house. Okay? Okay, so, you know, just a couple of other things I wanted to point out. But you see, I mean, that is so technically sophisticated, that pan at the beginning, you know, going into the book, into the vast overview, aerial view of the village, and then gradually moving down as if a camera is literally, you know, filming some kind of reality into the house, into the little house. One other thing I just wanted to mention is at the very beginning we have the book, right, which Jiminy Cricket opens. And this is a classic indication of adaptation, of, you know, just signaling that what we're seeing is an adaptation of a written text. And especially in films of the 40s, 30s, and 40s, we see this technique. I think a lot of the movies based on Dickens, based on Austen, and so on, you know, they'll have the book at the beginning so that it reminds us that what we're seeing is a kind of version of a classic. The strange thing about Disney's film, of course, is that it's very un-Italian. I mean, it's as if we're in the Bavarian Alps. You know, Pinocchio wears the little lederhosen. And Geppetto is kind of like Father Christmas or something. I mean, he's a toy maker. His little house is filled with wonderful little animated toys. And so it's very far from the Tuscan reality that Collodi, in some sense, captures in his tale. Even though his tale is a children's story, it's very realistic in portraying a poverty-stricken lifestyle. And Geppetto, in the original book, is a wood carver, but he's not a toy maker. And he lives in a house that has virtually no furniture. In fact, Collodi says that the only thing he has, really, is a painted fireplace on the wall with a painted kettle bubbling away. But that's as close as he can get to food, to real food. You know, he's a scrounger for food. And he creates Pinocchio in Collodi's version because he wants him to go out and earn a living. He says, I'm going to make a puppet who will be able to sing and dance. And he will go out and he will earn me money. You know, he'll support me. He'll be a good son and support me. Whereas in Disney, of course, it's all about love and cuteness and cuddles and so on. Not to say that it isn't, you know, very effective, but it's very, very far from the original book. Of course, all audiences, including adults, love the film. It's the beautiful, beautiful score, that wonderful song, When You Wish Upon a Star, the voicing of the characters. I mean, Jiminy Cricket is like Will Rogers, right? You know, you're listening to this wonderful, folksy voice. And the cast is pared down tremendously so that we can just get to concentrate on the major characters rather than as in the book where there are dozens of different characters that we have to keep track of. Okay. Again, in the interest of time, let's leave Disney for the time being and let's look again briefly at the opening scenes of Benigni's version, which is set in Tuscany and is much closer to the original, except that there is a tremendous emphasis on the blue fairy, as we'll see in the opening scenes. Surprise, surprise, the blue fairy is played by Benigni's wife, who is in everything that Benigni does, right? She was in Life is Beautiful. She's in all of his films. Most Italian critics say that they think she's a rather rotten actress, but, you know, she gets to be in all these wonderful films because she's married to Roberto Benigni. In any case, she's pretty good in this one because all she really needs to do is sit there and look like a magical blue fairy. So it's fine. It works okay. So shall we just see a little bit of the opening scenes of Benigni's Pinocchio? So maybe, you know, maybe that will tempt you to take a look at Benigni's film. As you can see, it's very beautifully produced. And there are many, many elements of the film that are excellent. It's just too bad that it didn't all come together into, you know, the wonderful Pinocchio that Benigni dreamt of for so long. Well, we have about 15 minutes, and there are many, many more things that I could say, but I thought at this point I just would like to leave you plenty of time to ask questions or make comments or respond in whatever way you might like to. So thank you very much for listening, and let's see if we can have a little conversation. Yeah. Just Pinocchio. Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. And it is available, you know, you can rent it easily, so yeah. It's really sort of, that is I think a real Disney invention. There's a cricket in the original Pinocchio story, who doesn't have a name and is really just a cricket, you know, a talking cricket, but he functions as sort of the conscience of the puppet. He's very he scolds him a lot and tries to keep him on the right path and so on. And at a certain point, Pinocchio, you know, throws something at him, tries to squish him. He wants to get rid of him. So yeah, this Jiminy Cricket, who becomes a sort of mouthpiece for the whole story and very folksy and so on. That's really a Disney creation. Yeah. Very effective, I think. I mean, we all, you know, love Jiminy Cricket. In the Disney film, there's a very good... Well, you know, that's a great question, and there's a very clear answer to it, which is that one of the major designers, animator designers of the film, wasn't German, but he was Swedish. And he knew, he was very interested in Northern European cities, landscapes, villages, you know. So it was really his vision. His name was Tengren. He was somebody who was quite known at the studio. And he just dominated the kind of visual imagination of that film. Yeah, yeah. Collodi?
Yeah.
That's a great question, too. We don't have a huge amount of information about him. He led a pretty uneventful life. He lived most of his life in Florence. He was a journalist and a writer. He was a very prolific writer. He had already written a lot of things before he wrote Pinocchio. This was in the latter part of his life when he did Pinocchio. He had written a series of other children's books that were much more openly didactic. You know, they were really kind of heavy, you know, stories about how to be good children and things like that. He also translated the Mother Goose stories, the Perrault stories from French, the fairy tale stories. He wrote a lot of journalism, and it had to do with politics, it had to do with social issues. But he never got married. He lived with his family, he lived with his parents until they died. And he was kind of a loner. So that's pretty much what we know about him. Yeah. He wrote a really funny book called A Trip by Train. I forget the full title. But it's when trains were just becoming to be used and created in Europe. And so they were a novelty. And he wrote this novel about a train trip, which presumably was going to be a kind of travel guide, you know, along the route. But it turns into this really surrealistic kind of book, and it's about people in their cars in the train and the conversations they're having. And one passage that is sort of unforgettable is when he all of a sudden goes off on this riff about the nose, You know, and when we see how important the nose is in Pinocchio, you have to connect the two. And he says that the nose is the seat of the emotions, right? That when people sneeze, they're expressing emotion. Well, of course, this is kind of right according to Freud. This is sort of pre-Freudian thinking, because Freud got really obsessed with the nose. You know, he had his buddy Wilhelm Fless, who was working on the nose as sort of the site of sexual dysfunction and so on. So, I mean, there's a lot of really interesting stuff going on in that early novel by Collodi, you know, about the nose and emotions. But it's just a fun book in general, because rather than being a travel guide, it's just this kind of surrealistic, you know, he'll go off on these digressions about the people sitting there in the cars and about the possible love affair between the young woman and the young guy who gets on. And then at a certain point, he'll say, whoops, I guess I'm supposed to be writing a travelogue, you know, and then he'll go back to the travelogue. That's a great question. You know, I mean, you all can help me with that. Can you think of examples? I mean, quite frankly, I can't. You know, I see it as something that's really pretty original with Collodi and with this figure. But there was certainly a tradition of transformation of non-human to human, you know, or even the birth of Pinocchio from a piece of wood. There was a long tradition of myths that had to do with tree people, you know, and there's a whole book actually in Italian on the myths that go into, that kind of back up this idea of the tree or the piece of wood that becomes a sentient being and then eventually becomes a human being. So there's you know, and of course there's just simply the long tradition of transformation going all the way back to Ovid, where people become gods, you know, who fall in love with mortals, and then the mortals turn into trees and sunflowers and all kinds of things. So Collodi's definitely drawing on that tradition. But as far as this idea of the nose and lying and everything, I don't think that most people have found a real source for that. You know, I think he just sort of thought that up somehow. Exactly. Yeah, if you make a face, it'll stay that way, right? Yeah, that's a great point. Yeah, I think it does talk to, the book really talks to a lot of kids' fears and a lot of kids' also aspirations, you know, about wanting to be real, for example, you know, which is another way of saying I want to be grown up or I want to be independent, you know. I mean, I think that's part of the appeal of the figure for little children, you know, is that he wants so much to be his own boy, you know, rather than to be a puppet and to be controlled in some way. No, that's in the book. That's in the book, absolutely. Yeah, so there's another example of transformation, yeah, when they go off to this so-called perfect playland, and in fact it's this horrible place where they eventually become transformed into beasts of burden. Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, you know, we all know that in fairy tales, there's so much cruelty, you know, and actually Pinocchio is a very dark book. It's a book that has a lot of mayhem, it has a lot of violence. Even the way Pinocchio is born from a piece of wood in the book, Geppetto is working this piece of wood and this little voice comes out of the wood and says, stop tickling me, you know, but then later he says, stop hurting me, you know, because he's cutting and he's planing and so on. So, you know, there's this idea of somehow he comes out of this act of sort of violence upon this piece of wood. But the idea of something being inherent in something vegetal or is very much allied to these myths, as I said, myths of tree people, and even the myth of creation. You know, Michelangelo talked, I'm going off on digressions, but I think they connect. Michelangelo, when he worked in his marble, in his carving, his sculpting, he truly believed that there were forms within the marble that he was liberating, And this is partly why those wonderful unfinished sculptures in Florence called the Slaves, which line the Academy corridor as you go to see David. You know, that's what everybody goes to see, right, is the great statue of David. But if you go there, be sure to look at the slaves, the statues that line the corridor as you walk in, because they are unfinished, and they really capture this idea of emerging form. You know, you sort of see half a head coming out, and you see a hand sort of beginning to form, and you get a real sense that somehow those forms are in the material. It was a kind of Platonic idea, right, that there are ideal forms that are imprisoned in matter, and that somehow art liberates those forms, you know, allows them to come to full life. And so I think Collodi, again, I think he's drawing on a lot of this. I mean, he was an educated man, and he was a man who certainly knew fairy tales, myths, and so on. That was a world that he did a lot of reading and a lot of work in. So I think it's logical to assume that he was playing with some of those ideas. Yes, yes, yes. Wow, that's really interesting. Yeah, I mean, you're gonna, so often, you know, if you're conscious of it, you'll hear allusions to Pinocchio in all kinds of contexts, and it's like, what's that? You know, where did that come from? But again, because it's such a universally known figure, and it elicits meanings immediately for people sort of across the board, you know. Yeah. I think so. I think that the sort of intense emotionalism, it would be seen as, you know, somehow part of this so-called national character. I mean, there was so much stuff on this when Benigni's film came out about 10 years ago. This is where this whole dialogue started coming out in the Italian press about, oh, you know, now the world is going to understand who we are. Because Benigni, who is our national actor, right, our symbol of Italianness in the world, in a comedic sense, is going to embody this figure that also embodies us in some very, very real way. The sort of harshness of the reality there. Simply the dishonesty. You know, the getting away with things. I was just reading this morning, I think, in the paper again, you know, a discussion of, this is in a book I'm reading called The Other Side of the Tiber, which is a wonderful story about an American woman who's been living in Italy for 30 years. And she has a chapter in there about how there is just this national acceptance of getting away with things, you know, in Italy. I mean, if you cannot pay your taxes and get away with it, it's okay. I mean, it's part of the reason that Berlusconi, you know, I mean, many, many Italians just shrug their shoulders and say, well, he gets away with it, you know, so, okay, he gets away with it. Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate you all coming. Have fun. Bye-bye.